Morning. Today's scripture reading is Isaiah 40, 21 through 31. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is He who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretch out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught, who makes rulers of the earth nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stems taken root in the earth when He blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then do we compare Him? Or who is my equal? Says the Holy One. Lift up your eyes on high and see who created these. He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because He is great in strength, mighty in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel? My way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youth will faint and be weary, and young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up the wings like eagles, and they shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. This is the word of the Lord.
Have you ever seen a play made for Godot? In my undergraduate studies, where I studied theater performance, one of my least favorite genres to study was absurdism, and it's exactly what it sounds like. Absurdism is a fictional, non-realistic artistic expression, and I get it was created in response to World War II to show the absurdity of human nature, but I just didn't get it. I mean, my friends were awestruck, I was kind of bored. But one of the absurdist plays that I've probably seen 100 times is Waiting for Godot. And once again, I just didn't get it the multiple times I saw it. You have these two guys waiting around for Godot, who never shows up, and they spend all their time arguing where and how and when to wait. Their impatience makes it so they don't finish anything. They keep repeating the same words and actions over and over, and they can't seem to actually come up with a reason why they should wait for Godot. When a messenger comes to tell them that Godot won't arrive that day, he'll arrive the next day, they then come up with all these things they should do instead, but end up doing nothing. The next day, the messenger shows up, tells them the same exact thing, and this vicious cycle of their inactive and impatient waiting continues. Scholars have tried dissecting the theological and ethical nature of this play for decades. But I bring this up not only because Godot sounds a lot like God, but when I was really trying to engage myself in a deep dialogue with today's Isaiah text, I may have stumbled upon one possible interpretation of Samuel Beckett's mysterious play. 2 years too late, but no. I'm going to take us all the way back to the last verse, Isaiah 40, verse 31. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. Now, this Isaiah things sound kind of scary. It talks about how those who do not wait for God grow weary and fall down exhausted and wither away. It can imply that, that we should then feel guilty for all the times we didn't wait for God, the times that we searched and tried to force God into what we wanted. But this is a rabbit hole. This guilt then makes us impatient, it makes us do things that we shouldn't, makes us say things without thinking, and loops us into a vicious cycle of getting angry with God for making us wait, instead of actively waiting for the Lord and seeing all the ways God is present in our day-to-day lives. Let's take me writing this sermon, for example. I wanted it done. God wasn't working with my schedule. So I wrote a really rough draft. Then I got mad and was basically like, well, I tried. It's not my fault, Lord. They didn't show up. Which then made me put off trying to improve it until I finally said, oh, all right, I'm listening. I got to tell you, it's the weirdest thing. Later on that very day, I show up in class, and the professor just decides that he wants to take the first half an hour to talk about some random passage. Let me just look through and he chooses this exact passage that my class had discussed for half an hour. And then a friend of mine recommended that I parallel it to a specific gospel text, which I then proceeded to not look into. And so when I finally willed myself to go to chapel at seminary after a long time of not going, what was the passage? That exact gospel text that my friend told me to look into. And that text is Luke chapter 2, verses 25 through 35. And in this passage of Luke, Simeon is told that he will see Jesus before he dies. He must wait, but his reward is the Son of God. We must wait. We have to search for the unsearchable, and the reward may not be what we're expecting within the time frame that we're expecting it, but the reward is Christ. God was trying to pass me the cheat sheet the whole time. But my unwillingness to wait only made it so I couldn't hear the word of God. Insert here the part where I look up to the sky and say, yeah, you big show up. But why does waiting make us so uneasy? Why does something so simple in principle seem utterly impossible? For me, my hesitation came from being tired. Now, I'm tired of waiting to hear if my dad's chemo's been increased. I'm tired of waiting to hear about my mom's health. I'm tired of being asked when my ministry's going to look like when I'm not any closer to figuring it out than I was 2 years ago. We're tired of wondering if the relationship will end. We're tired of wondering if we'll ever see that person again, if the bills are going to get paid. We're tired of seeing the destruction in the news, of hearing about the greater tensions in the world. We are tired of being told to wait. We are tired. Does it sound at all familiar? Now, Isaiah is a bit of a complicated book, to say the least, compared to all the easy books in the Bible. So, today's text is right in the beginning of what scholars can call Isaiah 2. Isaiah 1 is before the exile. Isaiah 2 is the Israelites in exile. Again. Dana, he painted this picture for us last week of the Israelites waiting, of their impatience, of Moses' 40-year plan not coming with the reward he thought he was going to get. And here in today's text, with the Israelites in exile, again, all that vulnerability and listening and patience that Danny taught us last week, well, it's reared its face to us once again. Isaiah 2, though, promises that restoration will come soon. This text is surrounded by poetry of crying out for God's redemption when all hope seems lost. Even the beginning part of this very chapter has a much more somber note than this section. But this text instead begs for hope in the everlasting nature of God. Verse 28 reads, "He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable." This idea of an unsearchable God is rather compelling to me because it kind of makes me go, like, what was I looking for this whole time then? There are times, and I bet I'm not alone in this, that God doesn't seem to be an active part of my life. There are times when the heavenly radio sounds static. patient. I'm unwilling to wait. I want it to look exactly how I think it should look, and I want it to look that way right now. This unsearchable understanding of God gives us wiggle room to cry out, "This doesn't make sense. I don't understand." It encourages us to bring that to God instead of trying to find that hope somewhere else. Bring it to God, then wait. And what's so interesting about this idea of waiting seen here and throughout the Hebrew Bible is that it's not some passive state that we tend to assume it is. Waiting is an action. Waiting is purposeful. Waiting requires great focus. Waiting requires patience. Waiting is very, very difficult. But notice that waiting doesn't present itself in all the ways we expect it to. This chapter concludes with, "They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." Some days, our hope and faith will mount us up like eagles. We soar. We're on top of the world. And other days, our hope and faith is what's able to make us will ourselves out of bed, out of that slump, and to finally face the day. What we wait for, what God is doing for each and every one of us, is so vastly diverse. And one thing may look like a blessing, while another may not, but that doesn't mean it's not the grace of God. Soaring, or just getting up. Focus on what God is doing, and that grace becomes clear, and waiting comes clarity. In waiting, there is then the space to acknowledge God. It makes me think of that famous Stanford study, the Great Marshmallow Experiment. The experiment tested children's ability of self-control and patience. It showed that kids who were able to wait to eat the second marshmallow instead of just eating the first marshmallow had a much better life long term. They were healthier, more educated, and they tested better. But waiting can be one of the most difficult things to do. It's so tough to just let your worries go. It's so tough to wait for the test results from the doctor, to see if the family will visit, for service to end because we're kind of hungry. But if waiting is the difficult answer, how can these Israelites in exile offer us such redemptive words that we hear in Isaiah 40? How can we look at all that has beaten us down and tired us and keep waiting? You know how there are those wedding gift lists that are like, "And on your 50th wedding anniversary, you shall give each other gold." Well, apparently, if you reach 5 generations of pastors in one family, you get a song. Because, as I recently learned, my family has a song that my father was legitimately like, "And now I will share with you the family song." But, jokes aside, it's a verse from Psalm 16 that my family has used as a grounding rock for generations. They're the words that make us stop and reflect and give thanks. "The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. I have a goodly heritage." When was the last time you stopped? That you looked at the feet beneath you? That you took in where you are, who you're with, who you've become? And acknowledge that the grace that you've been blessed with is grace of God. "Boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places." The redeeming hand of God is found in places least expected. When we fly like eagles, we just get out of bed. What seems like the worst possible situation can be drenched in God's guiding hand. God is found when we stop searching in all the places we expect God to be. It requires us to wait for God to reveal God's handiwork in God's own time. It requires patience. It requires waiting. Now, God's own time can feel awful slow. Can feel frustrating. It can feel like waiting for Godot. And we should support one another in this upcoming Lent season, in this season of waiting, to put our focus and patience towards God because of the redeeming